And some of you stayed in town, and we're just so blessed to have time with family and also to give thanksgiving to the Lord. In spite of, the history that some people claim about Thanksgiving, we know that this is always a good time to come together with family, remember our blessings, count our blessings. It's always good to count our blessings. And also to reflect on the goodness of the Lord in our lives. And today, we will be focusing on the reason why I said night, because the title of our message for this morning is "The Night is Almost Over." And we're going to see what this is all about. Why do we consider the night being almost over? And so we still continue to focus on hope and peace and thanksgiving, as today is the first Sunday of Advent. Remember, this is the last Sunday of November, and we're about to say hello to the season of Advent, the Christmas season, wherein we celebrate the first coming of Jesus Christ. And at the same time, this is the same season where we focus on His second coming. And that is what we should focus on. So this is something that we will highlight through our passage, which is found in Romans chapter 13, verses 11 to 14. And then later on, we're going to be tying this with what is written in Isaiah, in the book of Isaiah. And we will be connecting this prophecy and also inheritance and principles that the Apostle Paul has written to the early Christian believers in Rome. So please turn your Bibles, if you have them, but you have Bibles there at your seats, or just switch on your Bible apps and turn them to Romans chapter 13, verses 11 to 14. Romans 13, 11 to 14. And this is what it says. "Do this, knowing the time, that it is already the hour for you to awaken from sleep. For now salvation is nearer to us than when we believed. The night is almost gone, and the day is near. Therefore, let us lay aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave properly as in the day, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual promiscuity and sensuality, not in strife and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lust." Let us pray. Our dear loving Heavenly Father, we come before you right now, humbling ourselves, and before we go any further, O Lord, we would like to ask for forgiveness for all the sins that we have committed. Right now, Lord God, if there is anything unclean in us, if there is anything sinful in our hearts, we ask you to continue to convict us. We know, Lord God, that we are in progression of sanctification. And so right now, Lord God, we pray that you would continue to speak to us, that you would convict our hearts to just follow your will and change us, O Lord. Change us to who you want us to be, that we may be pleasing unto you. We give you back all the praise, the honor, and the glory. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So the night is almost over. But we've got to see what the situation is during that time. When Paul wrote to the church in Rome, he presented God's plan of salvation for all peoples. So he wrote to the church in Rome, and we have to realize that he was born a Jew, and he had a privilege wherein he was given a Roman citizenship, even though he did not live in Rome, even though he lived outside of Rome. He was given this privilege of having, you know, that's like dual citizenship, like being an American citizen and a Filipino citizen. So Other than that, in this circumstance, in the previous chapter, if we read the preceding verses, we can see there that Paul told the Roman Christians to live in a manner that would be worshipful to God. To live in a manner that would be worshipful to God. Of course, we're going to be seeing as well if Paul was saying how to do this, how he was trying to instruct the early Christian believers in Rome. So let's try to break it down verse by verse and segment by segment so we can truly understand what Paul was trying to say. So in verses 11 to 12, when we read there, "Do this, knowing the time that it is already the hour for you to awaken from sleep, for now salvation is nearer to us than when we believed. The night is almost gone and the day is near. Therefore, let us lay aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light." Well, we can see there that we are being told here that we need to be ready for the Lord's coming, for it is near. When we talk about sleep, for example, in verse 11, because we are told there to awaken, to be to awaken from our slumber. But the sleep that Paul was talking about here is the spiritual apathy and lethargy, and also the unresponsiveness to the things of God. Now that he is warning the people that Christ will come again, and he is telling them that the coming of the Lord is near, and their glorification, not the salvation that they have received upon conversion and upon receiving Jesus Christ, because when you receive Jesus Christ, you're already saved, you already experience salvation, but the glorification that is being talked about here is when the Lord Jesus comes again. And so when he was talking about being awake from spiritual apathy, and being lethargic, he is saying that we need to really ask the Holy Spirit to empower us to service and to worship. Well, worship comes first, then service. Because when we worship the Lord, that means that we place our faith in him first. We place emphasis on believing in the Lord, with the hopes that they will be saved and they will be delivered from any circumstance that they are struggling with. So at this time, we can see that Paul was saying, the time is near. Wake up. Wake up. We're not, it's not a time to relax, to dilly-dally, to consider that all there is in life is to wait for the next Black Friday or Thanksgiving or Christmas in order for us to feel good. He is saying that there is now the coming of the glorification, which is a result of our relationship with Jesus Christ. And that is of more value. That's why I'm saying it's time to wake up, guys. Time to wake up. Earlier, before coming to church, of course, I had to. We slept late last night because we came from a wedding, and then we needed to do some other stuff. And then we set our alarm clock to 5:30, and then we were thinking ahead because we think when you think that, okay, I won't wake up at 5:30, and then you set it again at 6, and then there's 6:30 and 7. And so, true enough, when our alarm went off at 5:30, my wife and I ignored it, and we just pressed snooze or stop. Because somehow, if you don't press the snooze, you press stop by accident, and you won't wake up anymore until the time that you want to wake up. So there's a fail-safe. We set it at 6 o'clock and then 6:30, and then later on, we found out that we ignored all of the alarms, and it was about to be 7 o'clock. So, oh no, we have a lot of things to do and prepare for. And so it reminds me of, you know, in our spiritual life, somehow we're given that warning, and then we don't heed that warning. We don't, we ignore it without any urgency. And we focus on other things, other mundane things that are not really spiritual. And we could, this could mean a lot of things. In fact, in the church right now, what should be the activity of Christians is to reach out to those who are unreached, to love those who are unlovable, and not to just make a spiritual club. Because somehow, that is what we're doing. We're creating a spiritual club. We're creating a place wherein Christians can be comfortable, especially with the people that they see. And if someone strange comes in, someone who dresses differently or looks differently, or we're starting to think about this person because that person looks shady and we think the worst of other people, we're not acting like believers. But in fact, the Lord, what we have to see that the Lord is calling us now to be busy, not busy necessarily with a lot of activities, but to just focus on Him, to study His Word, and to preach the gospel in all situations. That is what He means by waking up. It's not to wake up and do in a philosophy or a way of thinking. It is to wake up from spiritual apathy. Pressing the snooze all the time, saying, "Ah, makadalaman naman," you know, it's not coming. Some people warned us before that the end is coming and it didn't come, so it's not going to come in our lifetime, most probably. But you know what? I hope it happens in our lifetime, because that would be a glorious day if we are believers. What a glorious sight to see Jesus Christ come again and start His millennial kingdom. What a wonderful event that we don't need to struggle against fleshly lusts or even preferences, personal preferences. Because we focus now on the essential things, which is to glorify Jesus Christ. And later on, we're going to be highlighting what else, how else Paul wants us to act as believers. But in Matthew 24, 42 to 44, he mentions there, "Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you must also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect." You know, that is the mindset that we should have. It's not like we're being prophets of doom, but we prepare for the coming of the Master. Although the analogy here that was used was a thief, like a thief in the night, it's not saying that God or Jesus Christ is like a thief. But what is being discussed here is the nature of what would go on, that it would come by surprise. No thief would come knowing that the master of the house would expect his coming. Of course, this is also part of God's test for us. He wants to develop our faith, that we would not believe in Him just because we are afraid of hellfire. Not just because we're afraid of doom, because that is a selfish type of faith, but because we believe because of our relationship with Jesus Christ, because we know that He loved us first. And this removes any type of spotlight on us, thinking that we are perfect, that we are above reproach, or that we know everything. Actually, the Lord is telling us right now, humble yourselves and realize that the Lord is coming again and we need to be prepared. Not that believing in Christ is not enough, or not that having faith in Him is not enough, but we would prepare ourselves so that He may be glorified in our lives, and that other people may also get to know Jesus. Also in 1 Corinthians 15:33-34 says here, do not be deceived. Bad company ruins good morals. Wake up from your drunken stupor, as is right, and do not go on sinning. For some have no knowledge of God. I say this to your shame. Again, it's another reminder of Paul. Actually, he was admonishing the people, the early Christian believers at Corinth. And he was saying that bad company ruins good morals. Why? What was the situation before? You know, they were into paganism. They were into idolatry. And right now, somehow, we compartmentalize our faith. That what happens in the church is not brought into our personal lives. Somehow when we go to work, we speak differently from how we speak differently to speak in church. How do we know that? Well, of course, social media, the media makes it so much easier. Our status, our photos. Do we not think that the world is watching, and how can we become a good testimony to other people? But somehow we allow ourselves to be ruined by bad company. I know we are not told to shy away from non-believers. In fact, we are told to befriend them. We are told to have relationships with them. But the problem starts when we are influenced by the world rather than allowing the Lord to work through us so that our light would shine in the community. It doesn't matter if when we talk about the type of person that we are, because somehow we believe that, okay, Lord, I failed, and I keep on failing, and I keep on falling into sin. And somehow we believe that because of that, we are no longer worthy to serve Him. A newsflash is that although we are believers, we still struggle with sin. A reminder for us is that we, as we struggle in sin, that is the time that we call on the name of Jesus Christ. Not that our, again, it's important for me to stress that not that salvation will be lost. Because some people always ask me, okay, Pastor, I accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and personal Savior. Do I need to accept Him again because I sinned again? Do I need to come forward when you call for acceptance of Jesus Christ? Actually, no. When we sin as believers, what happens in our hearts? There is guilt that happens there. Somehow it doesn't feel right. Why? Because there was a change that happened when we accepted Jesus Christ. There was something that changed there. And that's how we know that there is growth. There is growth if there is change. There is no growth if we stay where we are. If we just believe that, okay, I'm fine the way I am. There's nothing wrong with me. There's nothing that I need to change. I don't need to become better. But you know, believers will not have this in their minds. Believers will always respond in humility. Why? Because of the work of the word, the conviction of the word of God through the movement of the Holy Spirit from our person's life. Now, of course, we can ask our question, what about this person? What about this guy on television, this rapper who claimed to be a Christian, and then he's doing something else? Well, don't worry about that guy. I know, right? I mean, somehow it can really be a stumbling block. But your faith should never be based on anyone else. In fact, that's why we should only focus on Jesus Christ. People will fail us, but it is only through the grace of Jesus Christ that anyone can stand up once again and start fresh. And that is why we should never run out of grace. You know, we will always fail in that. Expect it. But still, we are to study the Word of God and allow Him to convict us. But we may, you know, our sanctification is progressive. There is no such thing as, okay, I accepted Jesus Christ and I'm perfect. I am perfect in myself. Our perfection is not on our own. And this is really foundational doctrine here. Our perfection is not found in our own work. It is in the work of Jesus Christ. And in Christ are we made perfect. Not in our own perfection, but in the perfection of Christ. And it's the same way in 1 Corinthians 15, 33-34. Do not be deceived. Bad company ruins good morals. Wake up from your drunken stupor, as is right, and do not go on sinning. For some have no knowledge of God. I say this to your shame. So, when we just focus on trying not to be deceived, remember, a lot of circumstances may come. There are a lot of teachers out there who may come and preach a gospel. But how can we figure out the right type of gospel? Now, I'm not talking about disagreements with certain issues. Because somehow it's so easy to say that this person is not in the right because I disagree with certain things there. To say, to have discernment, we have to realize that if someone is teaching a different gospel, all right, we're not looking at the perfection of the person, because the person is not perfect. The message is what counts. And so when Paul says, do not be deceived, he's saying, go back to the source of truth. When in doubt, just go back to the source of truth. Be like the Bereans. And stop the drama. Just go back to the Word. And do the Word. Which is why, you know, also when we talk about bad company that ruins good morals, somehow Paul was also warning against people who claim to be leaders. People who claim to have spirituality. But again, in the end, it will only be strained by the work of the Holy Spirit and also by the Word of God. So we need not fret, brothers and sisters in the world. We need not worry. Because it is God, it is the Lord who will convict each and every person, and He will be the one to change a person's life. And so if we proceed to verses 12 to 14, and I would like to read to you aloud, we already went through verse 12. It says here, the night is almost gone and the day is near. Therefore let us lay aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Thus behave properly as in the day, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual promiscuity and sensuality, not in strife and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lusts. You see, some people may view this as behavioral alteration. Oh, it says here, Paul says that we have to behave properly. What does he actually mean by this? What was Paul trying to say? I thought that we were just, what really matters here is the faith, and the faith would transform us from within, and then we would produce good works. But what is this? You know, Paul does not preach about just simplistic moralism. That when we go to church, we need to dress a specific way, we need to act a specific way, and we need to get things together. We're expected to get everything together, to know everything. But this is not what Paul is saying. In fact, there was a term coined by some authors, Christian Smith and Melinda Lindquist Denton, in their book Soul Searching. You know what this term is? When Christians think that we are to just alter our behavior on our own, and we think that that in itself will cause us to be righteous. It's called moralistic therapeutic deism. Now this book that was written by the authors that I just mentioned in their book, Soul Searching, The Religious and Spiritual Lives of America, they did a study on young people here in America. And a lot of young people, they found out through interviews that they are moralistic in their faith. They believe that God just wants people to behave. God wants people to behave, and then therapeutic, what's the meaning of therapeutic? That God wants people to be happy and well-adjusted. And deism actually talks about a God who made the world and left it alone. That God is personally involved in the everyday lives of people. Now, it doesn't sound too bad, does it? You know, when we talk about, oh, God wants people to behave, yes, we want people to behave. We want our kids to behave. And then when we talk about the therapeutic aspect, that God wants people to be happy and well-adjusted, isn't God a good parent that he wants us to be happy and well-adjusted? But you know what? When we go to the deistic part, that there's a God who doesn't really care, and everything crumbles. No, Paul wasn't talking about just simply wanting people to behave. He was talking about when this context of behaving properly, this actually talks about living a life that is pleasing to God, manifesting in our outward behavior the inner reality of a redeemed person. So it is not the implementation or the imposing behavior. Even if I tell all of you, all right, start acting like me, I can't really change you. Now, can I? Can I convince you all to like Star Wars? Of course not. Or to like a specific music? We all have our individuality. We're all different from one another. But in the sense of spirituality, we all have our baggages. But what is being discussed here is not relying on our behavior so that we can be pleasing to God. Because we will never succeed. Nothing we do will be enough. So what in the world do? We rely on the strength of Jesus Christ. It's not about how other people will view you. But of course, we have to be conscious of how God is really working in our lives. People may talk about you, but when they're proven wrong by how you live your life as a result of your faith, because of the conviction of Jesus Christ, then the Lord is glorified. It's not just behaviorism. Like, for example, in our Sunday school, we teach children, okay, Jonah, you just have to be obedient. Unlike Jonah, and if Jonah only behaved or only followed the Lord, then no problem would arise. Or a Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, if just be brave. But we fail to see the true point of the story. It's not just the obedience of Jonah, but there's a deeper concept there. It is the love of God for the lost. And then in Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's experience in the furnace, it is the presence of the fourth companion that sets their story apart. Even if they were brave, they would still burn if not for the presence of Jesus Christ. So that should be relayed to the children. We should tell them that we are sinners. We are imperfect. And in Christ, we can just receive justification. That is now the filter. That is of that we view things through the lenses of Jesus Christ. It is not just wanting to behave. That's why I mentioned earlier, when we exist as a church, not just FIBC, but as a church, as an assembly. That's what truly binds us together. We're an assembly with Christ as a head. Whether you're from Africa, you're from America, you're from Asia, from the Philippines, or from Philadelphia. What binds you together, what binds us together is Jesus Christ. But what is our standard to welcome people? Is it behavior? Do we expect too much from new believers or even from sinners that we are always surprised? Like, for example, in the secular world, I cannot believe that this culture is permitting deviant behavior or alternative or deviant sexual behavior and lifestyle. Well, what do you expect? We are in a fallen world. What about, and this is what I tell my counselees when I officiate marriages. You know, your conflict is not because you are from different cultures or not just because you are from different backgrounds. It's because you are joining together two sinful people. And they can't come together because these people are just selfish. Not selfish, sorry. Selfish. Somehow that is the problem. Even if I tell the couple, or even if I tell people, hey, behave this way, it's not going to happen if there is no conviction and if there is no real work. The Holy Spirit. Now, if there's something wrong there, then there is a spiritual problem. There's something that goes beyond just behaviorism. And what about the therapeutic aspect? If God wants people to be happy and well-adjusted, does God just want our happiness? I believe that God wants us to be joyful. I believe that God wants us to be fulfilled, like our lesson last Sunday. He wants us to have a fulfilled life, like what in James 1 says. Having a full life means that we experience all the aspects of life. Challenges and all. I know it hurts. I know some of you who maybe who are also experiencing some challenges in your life. Probably you would come to a point that you would ask God, Lord, how long, oh Lord, how long? You cry yourself to sleep and say, Lord, what is going on? You know, you are in good company if you read the scriptures. Because almost all of them lamented to God. It's not all, praise God, oh, hallelujah. There are more passages here that discusses about lamenting. Even the heroes of the faith had to ask God, where are you, O Lord? Now you think that's my opinion? Check the Bible. Lamenting is a big part. That means struggle is a big part. In the life of the Israelites, how many times were they allowed by God to be subject to a different to oppressors? Started with the Egyptians, and then went to the Assyrians, and then the Babylonians, and then the Persians. And then you would ask, you know, God must not love Israel. Well, he keeps on saying, I love you even though you're so unfaithful to me. And that is the quality of the God that we love and we serve. We fail, but he still loves us. He still throws blessings at us. Even if we don't deserve it. So we see now what God is trying to do. He allowed Israel to go through suffering. He allowed Israel to go through turmoil. Because Israel was unfaithful to him. But later on, look at Isaiah. If we read Isaiah 13, if we read even Isaiah 2, and then the prophecy of the Messiah will come, then the Lord is saying, he's saying there, okay, someday your people will no longer cry. Before, and the nation of Judah, again, Judah and Israel, they were two kingdoms that were divided. But he mentioned that Judah, the people of Israel, will say, Lord, you were angry at us once, but now you have forgiven us. You are no longer angry at us. And now the wrath will be upon Assyria and Babylon because of the coming Messiah. That is now the prophecy that we can all hold on to. Before we were separated from the Lord. Before we didn't have access to God. Before we accepted Jesus Christ. And for those who have accepted Jesus Christ, wow, well done. Congratulations. God loves you. God cares for you. And God doesn't just want your happiness. He wants you to experience true joy. God isn't done with me yet. Because for me, I'm still trying to differentiate happiness from joy. Sometimes when, especially when I was relaying to you my experience, my emotional struggles, somehow it's so difficult to figure out, Lord, what is it? What is this? Is this a punishment? Is this a revelation? You know what God is saying? Whatever it is, whatever the purpose is that is hidden from you, my purpose is for you to experience a full life. To develop you, to strengthen you, and to teach you how to be more reliant on me. And so whatever that may be, like in the lives of the Israelites, whether it be conflict, whether it be turmoil or being subject to any other person or even utter humiliation. We know that God allows that to happen so that we can be spiritually developed. So when we talk about behaving properly, it is now not just behaviorism, not believing in a God who is distant. You know that song of who's that singer? The one who sang God is watching us from a distance. Bette Midler. I'm sure all of us sing that in our video game. We even stop. God is watching us from a distance. In the world, He is not distant. In fact, He is closer than ever before because of Jesus Christ. And so that, when we get that, when we put that together, we now can see that we can now put off the deeds of darkness and put on the deeds of light. Putting off the deeds of darkness, again, to be clear, is not behaviorism or moral behaviorism or being moralistic therapeutic, having moralistic therapeutic theism. But it is relying on the Lordship of Jesus Christ. It's not an opiate. It's not just escapism. Escaping, you know, the human responsibility. In fact, the Lord is telling us, be responsible to put Christ in your life. Put Him first. Place Him at the center. If you don't have Him in your life, all this is far from your reach. Like what is mentioned in Romans 12:2. Now it makes more sense when we read this. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed. Transformation is change, brothers and sisters. Be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Not being conformed to the pattern of this world is not just conforming to psychological suggestion or philosophical discussion or secular understanding. We are to put our faith in Christ first. And how do we do that? Just believe the Bible. Pray every day. Add Sunday school theology there. And it's so effective. The song, read your Bible, pray every day. Pray every day, pray every day, read your Bible, pray every day, and you grow. It can be so confusing at times, especially when we see a lot of, scholars and theologians. But if you read the Bible, and not read it like an encyclopedia, that's what we think. We read it like an encyclopedia. Aha! The Bible is a narrative. It's a story. The Bible tells us of something deeper. And if we read the Bible correctly, it's like a mirror. Uh-oh, what's going on in my life? What's happening to me? Why am I acting this way? And so the transformation happens from within. Even if someone spanks you, or flogs you, or scolds you, it will only be met with resistance. If there is no true conviction. That's why you find a lot of rebellious young people. Somehow we miss the point. But if we just instill in them true faith through the proper study of the Word, then we will definitely get somewhere. And Ephesians 4:22-24 says here, put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life, and is corrupt through deceitful desires. and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. This is a verse, these are verses that are taken from a bigger context. You know what they all was discussing there? Putting on the old self, or putting off the old self, or and putting on the new self. He was talking about being born again. It's not the change that comes from willpower. It is the change that comes from having a relationship with Jesus Christ. Put on the new self. And then Colossians 3:2 says here, set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. Setting your minds on things that are above is having faith. That what we see here is not the as good as it gets. You know, it's this is not it. There's something better than this. That's why we need not place our trust. Everything, our and all our strength in anything that is carnal. Sometimes, even if we think we're following the Lord, this is the reason why behaviorism doesn't work. Because suddenly, we try to say that, okay, I'll follow. But there are things that we do not follow. There are things that we overlook. What about those things? That means, no matter what we do, wala pa rin. We're still lacking. But if we set our minds on things above, in the context of really placing your faith in the Lord, realizing that I am made complete and my satisfaction can be found in Christ alone, then we have, you know, there's a burden that is lifted. Okay, Lord, here it is. Here's my life. I will surrender it to you. So this is a challenge for anyone who has yet to accept Jesus as Lord and personal Savior. Because what Paul was saying, we don't have enough time. We don't have much time. That is a sense of urgency, alarm for the person without Christ, but good news for the person who is in Christ. Good news because when He comes, we are going to join the rest of the body of Christ. You know? And our righteousness is found in Christ. Last thing about Jonah. Jonah disobeyed, right? Jonah was so hard-headed, even to the last part of the book. But did you fail to see it, even though he was imperfect, God still used him? Even though he went the other way, God was so merciful that he was still able to use this prophet for the salvation of the Ninevites. If you're sitting there and you're thinking that you're not worthy to follow Christ because of what someone else, some person said, just put that aside and wholeheartedly just commit to the Lord Jesus Christ. Something good can come from your commitment, and something good can come from your surrender. So, our takeaway, number one, read God's Word daily. We have to read God's Word daily. Not bad to be on Facebook. You're not a legalist. Not going to say, no, you're bad. That's behaviorism. Stop Facebook. You know, if your Facebook is working for you, go ahead. If you can find God's truth in a movie that you just watched and theologize, go ahead. I'm not that sort of pastor who would be, oh, man. What are you wearing? What are those? What is that? What is this? And before you can come in, you gotta fix yourself first. You gotta wear a coat and tie, or you gotta, you know, appear to be this way first. got to fix their life first. I don't think that's what the Lord calls us to do. But if we have time for these things that we enjoy, certainly we have time to read God's Word, and we have to give more time to do that. That's something, that's an imperative that we need to have. But we can't do that if we just rely again on our discipline. Pray to the Lord. Read God's Word and pray. Pray to God. Lord, as I read this, as I read your Word, be with me. Because even the Pharisees read the Word, but they read it like, like people who were just there to prove other people wrong. Number two, evade bad company and evil activity. Evading bad company means, it doesn't mean that we will not befriend outside of people who are unbelievers. Evading bad company means we do not want to be influenced by people that we think is having a bad effect on our spiritual lives. Right? If there's someone who causes you to be angry all the time, the Lord doesn't, and then you know that you can't deal with that, the Lord is saying, well, Christ died for that person, and it's not your job to be in that drama. And that is my personal belief of what Paul was trying to say. If there is anyone or anything that infects you with anything negative, evade it. Even a lesson, you know, that probably you cannot understand, try to seek help for it. But if you know that there is something that causes you to stumble, like things that we watch online. Some people are strong and they can just go through the internet without any worries of pop-ups. Then again, if you can't, if you know that you're weak, evade it. Evade evil activity. Some people think that if you're having a beer with a non-believer, and I'm witnessing to them because I'm showing that Christians are cool. Actually, if you really want to be intentional, if you want to sit with them, intentionally share the gospel with them. And do not be pulled into whatever they're saying. Because somehow, even as a young person, when someone pulls you to, okay, let's go to a club of dancing people. You know, when these people go there, you know, probably at first you can stand it, but then again you have to, it's like a monkey see, monkey do system. Imagine if you're just standing there, or you're just sitting there and you say, I won't look, I'm okay. But you're there, and you know that that is your weakness. Or if you have an addiction to alcohol, and you're with people who drink alcohol, we're only playing with fire. Or if you have a bad temper, and you're with people with bad temper, it only spells disaster. So that principle is from the New Testament. Evade bad company. Apply the teachings of Christ. If we apply the teachings of Christ, like what is mentioned in Matthew 24:42-44, we're not just listeners of the Word. Remember, applying God's Word, the teachings of Christ, doesn't mean that we show other people that we are applying the teachings of Christ. That is just false piety. Showing people that, oh, look at me, I'm so holy. What did Christ say? If we're going to be praying, what was the instruction for genuine faith? It's actually not wanting other people to realize that, wow, what a great person I am. But we always point to the Lord. Apply the teachings of Christ, even when nobody is looking. Don't worry about your non-believing friends who would say, you're a hypocrite. It's a given. People will call you a hypocrite. But again, a reminder, hypocrisy is not the presence of sin. It is the absence of honesty. And what honesty are we talking about? Are we talking about another type of honesty? No. Honesty means realizing, Lord, I'm a sinner. I'm imperfect. I can't handle this one. That is the context of honesty that Paul wants, and even the Christian precept of honesty. Now, if we don't have that together, if we're still thinking, I'm very good, then we did not get the teaching of Christ. And also, we are to develop a teachable heart. Are we teachable? Some people would come to church and say, I have been a leader for so long. I have been a leader here. I've attended this convention. I've attended this conference. I actually know that. So maybe this is, maybe we need to do what I need to do, what I want to do. If we develop a teachable heart, we realize that we come to church or we have fellowship with an empty cup. Aim to learn. We need to aim to learn. And that is a lesson that also, even for pastors, we need to learn. We need to involve ourselves in the different trainings. Go to these trainings. You don't know everything. Go and be mentored by someone whom you believe is a worthy teacher that you see in that person's life that you can be affected by. Aim to disciple as well. But first of all, before we can disciple someone, we need to develop a teachable heart. And then we are to yearn to serve the Master. All the things that are in here, if we do not put it into practice, or we do not exercise these things, it's all wasted. And so our involvement in church, you're not doing it to please anyone, not even to please the pastor, not even to prove that you are a very active person. We yearn to serve the Master because we are given this mandate to seek first the kingdom of God. We are to stretch our legs. We are to exercise our faith. So, can you see this? Read God's Word daily, evade bad company and evil activity, apply the teachings of Christ, develop a teachable heart, and yearn to serve the Master. Can you see the first verse there? Ready. It's like an acrostic. Ready. R-E-A-D-Y. So let's be ready for the coming of Christ. And now Advent season is here. Advent means it's like a preparing to receive our Lord. So He has come. He has died on the cross. He lived again. That is why we have eternal life for those who believe in the Lord. We have salvation. And we have the glorification that will happen when Christ comes again. And we have the power for progressive sanctification. But for those who do not have Christ, you still have time. It's not just a theory, and it's not just a principle, but it is truth and it is life that we need to accept. So let us close in prayer. Our dear loving Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for giving us this passage, Romans 13:11-14. Thank you for the truth that you have shown us. And we pray, Lord God, that you would awaken us, Lord, that we would be ready for your coming, that we would have the strength, rely on your strength, we would rely on your power, that we may put off the deeds of darkness, put on the deeds of light. Lord, right now, we continue to bow before you, that we continue, Lord God, to ask for forgiveness. Search our hearts. Lead us to the right path. And we pray, Lord God, that like what was implied by Paul, O Lord, that we would be transformed. We would have change in our lives. That although we fail, we may fail if we rely on our own personal discipline, but help us, Lord God, that we may have change from within, that slowly, O Lord, or gradually, daily, we would see your truth and we would become more like Jesus Christ. Lord, as we prepare to leave this place, we ask that you would keep us safe. We ask, Lord God, that you would give us your traveling mercy. And please remind us, Lord, that wherever we go, wherever we do, we are to offer our lives as a living sacrifice. Be worshipful in everything that we do, that we may be holy and pleasing unto you. And we also lift up to you all of our activities for this coming month. And we pray, Lord, that whatever activity that we do, the ultimate goal may be realized, that other people may believe in Jesus Christ. Right now, Lord, we still pray for the people who are here, although most of the people who are here are familiar to me. I just pray, Lord God, that if there is still anyone who is here that is in need of Jesus Christ in their lives, I pray that you would convict that person. I pray, Lord, that you would speak to that person, that truly that person may just submit to you and surrender to you today. And we pray, Lord, that we also, as a church, would be like nurturing mothers to the people who are in need of care and also of the Lord. We give you back all the praise, the honor, and the glory. This is our prayer in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. And I may the blessing